Okay, so I want to talk about the Global Peace Index. The Global Peace Index, how many people have heard of this index? Yes? Put your hand up if you have.
Okay.
Who has not heard of the Global Peace Index? Not heard. Okay, so this will be a... So how did we make a peace index? This is a 2015 report. It's been going for some time, and you can find a website. Let's look at the contents of this. So the Institute of Economics and Peace is an independent, nonpartisan, nonprofit think tank dedicated to shifting the world's focus to peace as a positive, achievable, and tangible measure of human well-being and progress. IEP achieves its goals by developing new conceptual frameworks to define peacefulness, providing metrics for measuring peace, and uncovering the relationship between business, peace and prosperity, as well as promoting a better understanding of the cultural, economic and political practice that create peace. IEP has offices in Sydney, New York and Mexico City. It works with a wide range of partners internationally and collaborates with intergovernmental organizations for measuring and communicating economic value and peace. The website is there. So each year they apply a set of criteria to different countries in the world and try to measure its peacefulness, and then see the trends. Okay. So, the executive summary, we see results and findings, trends in peace, global economic value of peace, why is peace economically valuable, and what's positive peace. Okay, as opposed to negative peace. Negative peace is the absence of war. Positive peace is something more positive, what we're trying to do to create. So if we were trying to be a youth peace ambassador, we might be trying to be an ambassador to work towards positive peace and against the negative aspects which contradict peace. Okay, so we can read the executive summary. This is the 9th edition of the Global Peace Index, which ranks the nations of the world according to their level of peacefulness. The index is composed of 23 qualitative and quantitative indicators from highly respected sources and ranks 162 independent states, covering 99.6% of the world's population. The index gauges global peace using three broad themes: the level of safety and security in society, the extent of domestic and international conflict, and the degree of militarization. Okay. So, you can read, I'll read some aspects of this report. You can read the whole report yourself. This year's report provides an updated methodology to account for the economic impact of violence on the global economy. The report also contains a new analysis of positive peace and describes its relationship to development and other significant and positive societal outcomes. Okay, so it says last year, in 2015, the Global Peace Index score remained stable. However, while the average level of global peacefulness was stable, a number of indicators in countries did deteriorate while others improved. 4 out of 9 geographical regions experienced an improvement of peace: Europe, North America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and Central America and the Caribbean. The other 5 regions became less peaceful. The most substantial changes in the index occurred in the Middle East and North Africa, where several countries suffered from an upsurge in violence related to the sectarian strife and civil conflicts, resulting in the region being ranked as the least peaceful in the world. You may not be too surprised with that, given the media attention on the Middle East. The societal safety and security domain improved slightly last year, driven by falls in the homicide rate and likelihood of violent demonstrations. The improvements in homicide rates mainly reflected data updates in some high homicide countries. So improvement in the homicide rate here. What's homicide?
Yes.
Killing.
Yeah.
Killing somebody. Okay. So improvement in the homicide rate from a peace index means decreasing the homicide rate.
Yeah.
Okay? It doesn't mean increasing rate. Improvement here is actually a negative, to decrease the homicides. And also the likelihood of violent demonstrations also declined. This improvement was counterbalanced by deteriorations in the ongoing conflict and militarization domains, owing to increased deaths from internal conflict, non-payment of UN peacekeeping dues, and continuing deterioration and the impact of the terrorism indicator. Iceland is the most peaceful country, with the 10 highest ranking nations in the GPI all being stable democracies. Nordic and Alpine countries are particularly well represented. Asia Pacific is also represented at the top, with New Zealand ranked 4th, Japan at 8th, and Australia at 9th. The Middle East and North Africa, MENA, now ranks as the most violent region, overtaking South Asia from last year's global peace index. Yet again, Europe maintains its position as the most peaceful region in the world, supported by a lack of domestic and external conflicts. It was also the region that experienced the largest improvements in the score compared to 2014, continuing its 8-year trend of improving peacefulness. This year, Guinea-Bissau has the largest improvement of peace, resulting in a rise of 24 places in the rankings to 120th. So actually, it wasn't in a very high position. That's why it could sort of move rapidly. The next four largest improvements were Cote d'Ivoire, Egypt, Tajikistan, and Benin. Common theme among the largest improvements was a fall in the level of organized conflict, which occurred in all of the four aforementioned African nations. Cancelling out its strong improvement in the 2014 edition of GPI, Libya experienced the largest deterioration this year. Okay. The second biggest decline was Ukraine. Okay. Other countries that deteriorated were Djibouti and Niger. Okay. So over the past 8 years, the average country's score deteriorated 2.4%, highlighting that on average the world has become slightly less peaceful. However, this decrease in peacefulness has not been evenly spread. 86 countries deteriorated and 76 improved. The 8-year downward trend in peacefulness has been driven predominantly by deterioration in indicators of internal peacefulness. Of the five key indicators that deteriorated by more than 5%, four are internal and one is external. Refugees and internally displaced persons, as a percentage of the population, deaths from internal conflict and impact of terrorism, the likelihood of violent demonstrations and perceptions of criminality. The deterioration indicators measuring the number of refugees and impact of terrorism is most concerning. And here you see estimates from UNHCR of 50 million people, refugees or internally displaced. Terrorism has grown steadily. We hoped that terrorism would be falling. Terrorism is growing. And it mentions 82% of terror deaths occurred in five countries: Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nigeria, and Syria. Several indicators of external peacefulness actually improved in the last 8 years. Relations with neighboring countries has grown stronger, particularly in South America. And financial contributions to UN peacekeeping funding has improved. So in the UN, based on your gross domestic product, your income, you pay some contribution for UN peacekeeping. However, not all countries pay that. And you can pay for different measures. UN peacekeepers have been in the news recently, unfortunately, for sexual abuse of minors. And there was a big apology last week. The largest contributors to peacekeeping, you could measure both in terms of money, or you could measure in terms of people's lives. And Bangladesh is one of the large suppliers of people who go and fight peacekeeping operations. Peace is becoming more unevenly distributed. And it talks about that. It has sections here on the economic impact of violence on the global economy. In 2014 was substantial and estimated at $14 trillion, 20% of the world GDP. Okay. And so basically, as this picture says, violence costs about 13% of the world GDP. One can ask, however, what about the countries who support the military industry, who are generating military income? So, in the long term, we can say violence costs GDP. For some industries in particular, however, they profit from violence. There's a section on positive peace, which if you're interested, you can read here. And there's some thematic analysis of three domains of a global peace index: ongoing domestic international conflicts, societal safety and security, militarization. Okay, so these are all, I think, very useful. I think they've done a good job in the last 9 years to try and have a measure of how we might measure peace. Because often people have talked, is the world more peaceful? That's why the United Nations was founded in 1945 to try and make the world more peaceful. The League of Nations was founded in 1919 and onwards to try and make the world more peaceful. And sometimes governments intervene in other countries' affairs in the name of trying to make the world more peaceful. So if we can actually have a measure of peace and security, then this will be useful. And I would like to go to particular sections of this report to look at that. If we look at the map of some regions, a state of peace, if it's very high, is in green, very low is in red. It's rather interesting that you have, in the Americas picture they start with, at the ends, it's more peaceful than in the middle. Yeah? Maybe in the tropics, people are more hot-headed. Red is not a good indicator. You can see certain countries which are red, not representing political ideology anymore. But this is a, you have some bastion of peaceful countries here, and then some countries which are really plagued with violence and insecurity. So the first part is a regional overview. I won't go through that. I want to look at the indicators. Because I think the indicators is interesting both intellectually and in the policy of how we might measure peace. And then you can apply this to your community peace index if you want to create such a community peace index of how you would measure peace. And it's also useful, here we have the different countries, so let's say you are working in a regional organization, you can compare, you know, different countries, and then see if your policies have led to a more peaceful nation building or not. Okay. So, ongoing domestic and international conflict, this is one of your indicators. Okay, so, I think, in fact, we'll go to the end where we look at the indicators. On methodology. So can you go to page 101 of the file, if you're following us electronically, for those on Skype especially, page 101 is the annexes. Measuring the state of peace. Peace is notoriously difficult to define. The simplest way of approaching it is in terms of the harmony achieved by the absence of violence and fear of violence. Negative peace. And so we can look at this indicators here. Okay. Ongoing domestic and international conflict, militarization, social safety and security. External peace, and they have different weight factors here, and you can look at these indicators. Internal peace, level of perceived criminality in society. Are you afraid of crime, for example? Number of internal security officers and police per 100,000 people. Presumably, a higher number is not good. It represents less peaceful. Number of homicides per 100,000 people. Okay, so here, for example, quantitative measure, indicator weight for indicator weight percentage, 5.3% of the total score. And the scoring basis. Number of jailed population per 100,000 people. Okay, so if you have more people in jail, it's not a sign of peace. Yeah. Can anybody tell me which country in the world has the highest prison population?
U.S.
United States? Yeah. Do you know how many people are in prison in the United States?
Well, maybe 2.5 million at least.
Yes, 2.5 million people. In prison.
That's
okay, it's around 7% of the population. Imagine putting 7% of the population in prison. It doesn't sound like a very useful thing to do. Okay. So, because you have to look after them. So there's 7% of probably very active people who are basically dependent on others and jail.
There's a pretty fair percentage of those people that are in there for nonviolent crimes like drug, involvement with the drug trade. And there's also a fairly significant minority of people that have mental conditions who, for lack of treatment facilities, which are all shut down, are incarcerated because there's no other place. Either they were public nuisances or causing a disturbance or some other way to draw attention to themselves, so they're residing in jail because there's no other place to keep them.
Yes, approximately 1 million mentally disturbed people are in prison in the United States.
But sir, maybe the policing is just effective, that the police are able to catch these criminals, because in some places there may be less number of people in jail, but the police are not able, but the reason is because the police are not able to catch them, or the implementation of the laws is not that.
Yes, maybe there's more criminals outside. Another question is, do we want these people inside jail or not? As Len mentioned, if it's non-violent crimes, is it useful to have them in prison? I mean, if they're causing harm to people, but if they're not causing harm to anyone else, such as some of the drug users, if they're not actually causing harm to people, it seems a bit of a waste to put them in prison. And ethics would say, based on liberty, that I can only infringe your liberty if you're going to harm somebody else, not harming yourself. Now, of course, the drug trade harms people, but many of these people who sell the drugs, unfortunately, in there, were just trying to harm themselves.
There's a very significant movement in the United States now to try to either rehabilitate people that are on drugs and instead of jailing them, or do home monitoring where you wear a band. Essentially, the push is to get nonviolent offenders back on the street. They're finding out to jail somebody is hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, and the jails are all jammed. In fact, they're growing. Well, the prison population is a growth industry. So they're trying to take people who have minor crimes and get them out of jail, either on probation or on monitoring or whatever, to try to reduce the prison population. So it's the attitude is shifting from, well, if you screw up, throw them in jail, problem solved, to where that's not very effective, because people in general become much more hardened in jail. And what they're finding is, even if people get out of jail, they're unemployable because of their criminal record, even if they have needed skills. So there is a push, there is a movement away from incarceration to other alternative treatment programs, but it's still, the prison population is still a growth industry in the United States.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And Arif makes a comment on Skype, more prisons in the United States than universities.
Yeah, for sure.
Really?
Yes. Well, unfortunate. Ease of access to small arms and light weapons, so you can have handguns, so that's another measure. Intensity of organized internal conflict, level of violent crime, likelihood of violent demonstrations, political instability. Thailand might not measure too well on this one. Political terror scale, volume of transfers of major conventional weapons as a recipient of imports. Okay, so, you know, large number of weapons. Impact of terrorism, number of deaths from organized conflict, internal. Military expenditure as a percentage of GDP, number and duration of internal conflicts, number of armed service personnel per 100,000 people, financial contribution to UN peacekeeping missions is probably a positive indicator, nuclear and heavy weapons capabilities, against a negative thing to have nuclear weapons, number of refugees and internally displaced people as a percentage of the population, volume of transfers of major conventional weapons as a supplier, relations with neighboring countries, number, duration, role in external conflicts, number of deaths from organized conflict, external. Okay, so these are the measures in the appendix, which I think are very, these are a key part of how we might measure. And we could develop a peace measure based on this, or adding some elements. But that's how you might try to find peace. We're going to come back to some elements of looking at peace in some other parts of the conference, but I would like to move on to some other presenters.
Okay.
And we may not be able to have all the presenters before lunch, we may have some after.
Okay.